Good morning and welcome to church on this very beautiful winter morning. It's Communion Sunday, the gifts of God, of bread and wine for the people of God. And so whether we're here at church this morning in this building or if you're worshiping with us online, may we together feel the communion of the Holy Spirit. This week, if you look at your schedule, there's lots of things happening at church this week and Bible study, bowling, friendship, Euchre night coming up on February the 9th. So lots of things to look forward to and get involved in. And please look into that and see where you can thank you. See where you can get involved. Also a reminder that we have coffee after church, so you're welcome to join us there. If you're visiting or regular members, come back for some good fellowship and some good coffee. This late announcement, Bill S-210 is an act that makes it an offense for organizations to make sexually explicit material available to young persons on the internet. It also enables a designated enforcement authority to take steps to prevent sexually explicit material from being made available to young persons on the internet in Canada. If you support this bill, you can sign a petition which will be presented to our members of Parliament. Copies of the petition will be available in the foyer and in the fellowship hall after the morning service. If you have any questions or concerns, please contact Bob Dieleman. We thank God for the gift of voices and of music, that together with voices and instruments, we can worship and we can praise God. So let us do that today and give God the best that we have to worship Him.
Yes, please stand in body or in spirit for God's call to worship. Do we have the litany there? I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, "Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb." Today our voices join this ongoing heavenly hymn of praise. In Jesus' name, let us worship our God. Family and friends, receive God's greeting. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be and abide with you all. All God's people say, Amen. You may be seated. Of a short children's message, but you guys don't have to go to the front this time. You can stay in your chairs. I have some bad news. Did you notice who's not here today? Uh-oh. Mrs. Deb isn't here today. What does that mean? No candy? There is candy. I brought candy. So you have to come to the foyer after church to get candy. But you guys didn't realize it maybe, but when you guys run to the front, you're giving us a beautiful story of you running to Mrs. Deb. She's usually sitting over here somewhere. Because you trust her, she loves you, and you love her, I hope, and she's given you good gifts, right? And that's a beautiful picture of what God wants us to be like, running to him because we trust him and love him, and he has good gifts. And we're going to celebrate one of God's good gifts right now in the supper. So boys and girls, after the final song, after the Lord's Supper, you can go to Sunday school. Just some logistics for people that maybe haven't taken the communion here before. We do allow children to come to the table, but we leave that up to the parents to discern if their children are old enough to do that. Also, the bread is gluten-free, and it's grape juice. And the for our drinks. Your Thanksgiving. People of God, lift up your hearts. We lift them up to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. With joy we praise you, gracious God, for you have created heaven and earth, made us in your image, and kept covenant with us, even when we fell into sin. we give you thanks for Jesus Christ, our Lord, whose coming opened to us the way of salvation and whose triumphant return we eagerly await. Therefore, we join our voices with all the saints and angels and the whole creation to proclaim the glory of your name. Let's sing together. Brothers and sisters, we give thanks that our Father, through the Lord Jesus Christ, gave us this memorial of his death until he comes again. Before taking bread, Jesus prayed and gave thanks, and he broke it, and he said, "This is my body given for you." In the same way, after the supper, our Lord Jesus took the cup and said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. The memorial acclamation. Therefore, we proclaim our faith as signed and sealed in this sacrament. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let's pray. Creator God, be present with your life-giving word and Holy Spirit, that we and your entire church may be called out and made whole through this supper. Grant that all who share the communion of the body and blood of your Son may be united in him. And may we all remain faithful in love and hope until we feast joyfully with Christ in the coming of the kingdom. Amen. The passing of the peace. Thanks be to God, Christ makes us one. The peace of Christ be with you all. Brothers and sisters in Christ, the gospel tells us that God, by the leading of a star, manifested the Savior to the peoples of the earth. And by the power that enabled Christ to change water into wine, made known his glory to his disciples. Come then to the joyful feast of the Lord and be transformed. Then Jesus said, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." Thank you. Take and eat. This is the body of Christ, which is for you. On the last and greatest day of the festival, Jesus said in a loud voice, "Let anyone who is thirsty come to me and drink. Whoever believes in me, as Scripture has said, rivers of living water will flow from within them." Take and drink and remember and believe the precious blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ was shed for the complete forgiveness of all of our sins. The Thanksgiving. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Praise the Lord, O my soul. Who forgives all your sins. Who redeems your life from the pit. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength, honor and glory and praise. Please join me in a closing prayer. Strengthen us, O God, in the power of your Holy Spirit to bring good news to the poor,
and lift blind eyes to sight, to loose the chains that bind and claim your blessing for all people. Keep us faithful in your service until Christ comes in final victory, and we shall feast with all your saints in the joy of your eternal realm. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And all God's people say, Amen. The children can be dismissed for Sunday school, and we'll sing our song of response.
We are privileged to go to our God in a time of intercessory prayer. Let's go to Him. Lord God and Heavenly Father, glorify yourself in all the earth. Be glorified in creation. Be glorified in your church. Be glorified in our worship here this morning. Though we are small and you are great, help us to magnify your holy name. Help us to make your name and the nature of your grace larger and easier for people to see. Help us to live and to worship in such a way that our neighbors and co-workers and children and friends
can see you come into focus in ways they may not have seen before. When people ask for an explanation of the hope that we have, give us the words to answer thoughtfully and well. When people wonder out loud who Jesus is and why he matters, help us to reply in words that will echo the sweetness of your gospel. Help us to magnify your name, O Lord, so that you will be glorified in all the earth. Father, ours is a world that could use more glimpses of your glory. Ours is a world that needs more of the gentle words of your Son, Jesus, and fewer angry words. We need your glory, Lord God, so that we can aspire to be more like you and less like the selfish, indifferent creatures we have become in our sin. We need the glory of your grace in a world bent on revenge, the glory of your truth in a world in love with lies, and the glory of your holiness in a world filled with injustice, and the glory of your beautiful resurrection in a world mired in death. With the power of your Holy Spirit, help us to demonstrate what the kingdom of God can already be like in the here and now. Help us to see through your eyes and have compassion as you have compassion. Bless our congregation. Be with Tanya and Gerald and Diana, Jennifer and Justin and Evie, as they continue to grieve a beloved husband and father and Opa. Comfort them, Lord, as only you can. Lord God, we are thankful that Brenda Grievers could return home from hospital, and that Bertha Bacher and Tia Veenstra could leave the hospital and settle into new homes that we pray will be a blessing to them, even in a difficult time of transition. We continue to lift up Peyton and ask that you would be merciful. May her upcoming tests reveal the best ways to restore her health. Father, we continue to remember Rob Slager and his ongoing health struggles. May further tests either result in further healing or the opportunity to continue his recovery at home. Lord God, reassure all those in our church family who feel anxious about what the future may hold. Bless the leadership of our church, both our English-speaking and Spanish-speaking communities. Anoint us by your Spirit, that we may feel your anointing. Be also with each and every member of this church family. In the words that we speak, and the cards and texts and messages we send, the visits we make, and the service that we do together, may we be a great encouragement to one another. And may we extend that grace to everyone we meet along the way. Empower us, Holy Spirit, to provide hope and to lend comfort, all to your glory. Be with all of us as we continue to worship you now, and may the eternal truths of your word be written upon our minds and on our hearts. It's in Jesus' name we pray, and all God's people say, amen.
This morning's scripture is from the book of Jonah, chapters 3 and 4. Then the word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time. Go to the great city of Nineveh and proclaim to it the message I give you. Jonah obeyed the word of the Lord and went to Nineveh. Now Nineveh was a very large city. It took 3 days to go through it. Jonah began by going a day's journey into the city, proclaiming, 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. The Ninevites believed God. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. When Jonah's warning reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. This is the proclamation he issued to Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, do not let people or animals, herds or flocks, taste anything. Do not let them eat or drink, but let people and animals be covered with sackcloth. Let everyone call urgently on God. Let them give up their evil ways and their violence. Who knows? God may yet relent and with compassion turn from his fierce anger so that we will not perish. When God saw what they did and how they turned from their evil ways, he relented and did not bring on them the destruction he had threatened. But to Jonah, this seemed very wrong, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord, "Isn't this what I said, Lord, when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you are a gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love, a God who relents from sending calamity. Now, Lord, take away my life, for it is better for me to die than to live." But the Lord replied, "Is it right for you to be angry?" Jonah had gone out and sat down at a place east of the city. There he made himself a shelter, sat in its shade, and waited to see what would happen to the city. Then the Lord provided a leafy plant and made it grow up over Jonah to give shade for his head to ease his discomfort. And Jonah was very happy about the plant. But at dawn the next day, God provided a worm which chewed the plant so that it withered. When the sun rose, God provided a scorching east wind, and the sun blazed on Jonah's head so that he grew faint. He wanted to die and said, "It would be better for me to die than to live." But God said to Jonah, "Is it right for you to be angry about the plant?" "It is," he said, "and I'm so angry I wish I were dead." But the Lord said, "You have been concerned about this plant, though you did not tend it or make it grow. It sprang up overnight and died overnight. And should I not have concern for the great city of Nineveh, in which there are more than 120,000 people who cannot tell their right hand from their left, and also many animals?" This is the word of the Lord.
Brothers and sisters, a common exercise for aspiring creative writers is to write a six-word story. So I typed this prompt into my favorite AI, ChatGPT. Write me some six-word stories, and here's a few examples of what I got back. Lost key, found love, opened heart. Last dance, first kiss, forever memories. And here's one a little more sinister. Crimson roses, thorns concealed, love betrayed. In 2012, the magazine The Christian Century posed the same challenge, though with seven words, to some current theological thinkers. Tell the gospel in seven words, and here are some examples. God, through Jesus Christ, loves us anyhow, by Martin E. Marty. Baylor professor Beverly Gavanta offered, in Christ, God's yes defeats our no. Pastor Martin Copenhaver's contribution was, God gets the last word. And Nadia Boltz-Weber gives us this one, we are who God says we are. And your pastor came up with this one, God uniting heaven and earth in Christ. All of this brings us to our text this morning and to our prophet Jonah. Jonah's work of evangelism in Nineveh. Nineveh is this huge city, a 3 days walk, the text tells us. It sounds a lot like the GTA. Jonah ventures in not quite a full day's journey, and he begins his missionary effort. After thinking he could run away from God, being tracked down by a storm, gobbled up by a whale, puked out on dry land, and gifted with a second chance at all this, you'd think that there'd be no shutting Jonah up. You would think that he would be bursting at the seams to tell the people of Nineveh about the amazing grace that found a wretch like me. About the grace that is far greater than all of our sin. About how God is steadfast in mercy and abounding in love. That's certainly been Jonah's own personal experience of God. So you would think that he has more than enough reasons for praise and for gratitude and for testimony. Just imagine all that he has to say. But when he opens his mouth to say it, here's what comes out. 40 more days and Nineveh will be overthrown. 8 words. 5 words in the Hebrew. That's all the text tells us that Jonah offered to the people of Nineveh. Not exactly a Billy Graham crusade, is it? After receiving grace upon grace, chance after chance after chance, Jonah finally obeys God, goes to Nineveh, and does almost precisely as little as he can possibly get away with. Author Eugene Peterson gives this estimation of Jonah's character. Jonah, obedient, turns out to be as much in violation of the word of God as Jonah, disobedient. Jonah is worse obedient than he was disobedient. Jonah, obedient, is angry and vindictive. Jonah hates Nineveh. Jonah despises Nineveh. Jonah obeys to the letter of the command of God, but Jonah betrays the Spirit of God with his anger. Now, why is Jonah so angry and so bitter? It's because Jonah is a racist. Jonah is ethnocentric. He believes that the Israelites are better than, more deserving of, than the Assyrians. Jonah is disgusted by the Assyrians. I wonder if there's any group of people that we are disgusted with today. Are there any neighborhoods in our city that we find disgusting? Any people groups or categories of people that we feel superior to? No, you say, I don't think I'm superior to anyone. Well, what if we replace Nineveh with the political party or political leader we disagree with? Does an air of superiority creep in our debates or our discussions when it comes to politics? Okay, maybe politics isn't your thing. Maybe our superiority relates to gender. Perhaps we're quite comfortable with the centuries-old boys' club way of doing things, a way that disregards or demeans a woman's perspective and wisdom. Or maybe our superiority complex is socioeconomic. We think that the homeless in our city, they're all just lazy and they deserve to be where they are. Or we think that the rich are all greedy and stingy and worldly. And there is the superiority complex that infects many a religion. As Christians, do we look down on anyone with different religious views? Do we think lesser of the person who wears a turban or a hijab? People of God, ours might be more subtle or less obvious than Jonah's prejudice. But deep down, or maybe just a little under the surface, it's there. It's that ever so smug arrogance that we think we are better than some other group for some reason. And when that happens, we had better contact ground control. Houston, we have a problem. Or in our case, we need to contact heaven control. Heaven, we have a problem. We found some prejudice in our hearts that might impact our mission to make disciples of all nations. And our vision is blurred because of it. We're having a hard time seeing the glory and the honor of the nations around us. That's certainly what happened to Jonah in our text today. Notice how Jonah distanced himself from the city. Jonah went east of the city. He moved out to the burbs. And he made a shelter. From there, it was much more comfortable than his very brief time in the heart of the city. A plant even grew up and covered his head. Yes, Jonah's got his Arnold Palmer t-shirt, a lawn chair, a nice cup of iced tea, and he's listening to his favorite podcast, Let It Burn, Let It Burn. East of Nineveh, Jonah doesn't have to deal with the sounds and the smells of the city. Jonah has distanced himself from the Ninevites, both in geographic proximity as well as in his heart. Sure, Jonah's checked the box of obedience, but he's checked out when it comes to compassion. Checked out. By moving away from the city, Jonah won't have to see the city's most vulnerable groups, the sick and the hurting, the women and the children. By moving away from the city, a disgusted and distanced Jonah can now quite easily depersonalize the people in that great city. Distancing ourselves from others allows us to depersonalize problems. We can talk and talk about how to deal with the addiction problem in our city, or the homelessness or housing crisis. But on the other side of those issues are real flesh and blood people. Single moms trying to make enough to feed her family. Young men more than willing to work, but find themselves addicted to a substance that now controls them. And real people with first and last names. Somebody's son, somebody's daughter. All people created in the image of God. Brothers and sisters, do we know more about problems than we do people? Do we know more about problems than we do names? If that's the case, maybe we're doing something wrong here. If we are so far removed that we are detached emotionally and empathetically, then we need to repent. And we need to build bridges back to the city to be the hands and the feet of Jesus, the one who moved into the city, set up his tent. But Jonah prefers his new suburban lifestyle because it allows him to distantly and coldly observe rather than proactively participate. Jonah has insulated himself from the problems and the pain. Look at what it did to Jonah's heart. His heart is as hard as a rock. Look at the story with the plant in chapter 4. A plant that grows up on its own, God later allows to be destroyed. And is Jonah ever angry? God says to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about this plant? It is. I am so angry, I wish I were dead. Jonah thinks he has just cause for complaint that this plant has died. I notice that God doesn't point out Jonah's self-pity, which he certainly has. But the Lord said, you have been concerned about this plant. Jonah has pity for this plant, of all things. Though you did not tend it or make it grow, sprang up overnight and died overnight. Seriously, Jonah? You're upset about a plant? A plant that you did not plant and you did not water? You have pity for this one soulless plant, Jonah, but not the 120,000 people who are caught in the crosshairs of my justice, says God. You are angry that I have pity for Nineveh, people whom I did plant, people whom I've created in my own image, people who don't know their right hand from their left. In other words, they don't know what they're doing. Should I not have compassion for them, Jonah? Should I not have compassion for them? The people of Nineveh, everyone, are like sheep without a shepherd. What they need is a shepherd to show them a way, a good shepherd. Now, where do we see and hear this imagery of a sheep without a shepherd? Isn't that the image that God uses to describe Israel over and over and over again? Psalm 78 is a good example that goes through Israel's disobedient history. How they kept turning from God over and over again. But then in verse 52, we read of God's grace to his people, but he brought his people out like a flock. He led them like sheep through the wilderness. God has been the good shepherd to Israel. And Assyria needs the same good shepherd. But up until this moment, Jonah cannot identify with the Ninevites because he isn't in their category, thinks Jonah. He thinks he's way above them. But what God is trying to reveal to Jonah and to all of us with our prejudices is that Jonah and we are just like Nineveh. There is no us versus them. There's only us. We are the city. We are the culture. We are the problem. Jonah and Nineveh and you and me are all sinners in need of the grace of God. Brothers and sisters, I believe that one of the biggest reasons why the modern church, the modern Christian church, is not as relevant in the world today, why we are not as relevant as we could be to our surrounding culture, is that there still is this pervasive spirit of Jonah in our churches, where we somehow believe that we are better or categorically different from the people that we live with. Church, we are Nineveh. We are the best and worst parts of the city. And if we insist on categories, there are only two: Jesus, the sinless one, and everybody else. We are all broken. We are all enslaved to the powers and the principalities. We all fall short of the glory of God. We are all in need of the grace of God. And thanks be to God, there is a 9-word summary of the gospel in Romans 5, verse 8. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Thankfully, with God, there is always and yet. And yet, were the Ninevites doing a whole lot of wicked things? Sure they were. They most definitely needed to turn around. So does Jonah, God's own prophet. But here is the good news in 4 words. God's grace is enough. God's grace is enough. It's more than enough, and Jonah knows it. Jonah's always known it. I like the narrator of Jonah, who intentionally puts things out of chronological order all throughout this book. In Jonah chapter 4, the narrator finally tells us why Jonah ran away from God in the first place. Jonah wasn't afraid to make the long trip to Nineveh. Jonah wasn't afraid that the people might not listen to his message. Jonah was afraid that the people would listen to the message. Jonah was afraid that God would soften hardened hearts and open blind eyes and unplug deaf ears. Jonah was afraid of the worst possible scenario, that God would stay in character. Jonah knows that his God is gracious and compassionate, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love. Just like a little kid with a temper tantrum, Jonah goes to God in prayer and basically says, "I told you so! Isn't this what I said when I was still at home? That is what I tried to forestall by fleeing to Tarshish. I knew that you are a steadfast, or gracious and compassionate God, slow to anger and abounding in love. A God who relents from sending calamity." And that's exactly what our gracious God did. Instead of disaster, he returned grace. No, God did overturn Nineveh, just not in the way Jonah was hoping. God turned these people upside down, and they found themselves in a beautiful posture of repentance and faith and hope. But here, as in chapter 1, Jonah plays the fool, the court jester in the royal palace, in order that we might hear the story of God from a very unlikely source. In chapter 3, we see God's story in the actions of the Assyrian king. While Jonah is dragging his feet and saving his voice with his five-word message, the king, we are told, rose from his throne, took off his royal robes, covered himself in sackcloth, and sat down in the dust. Sound like anyone we know? Sounds a lot like Jesus, King of kings. These are the humble actions of Christ, everyone. Christ who gave up his throne in heaven to come down to earth, to feel our pain, to experience our longing and our grief. To turn our prejudice into compassion. Jesus even died on the cross in our place, the perfect sacrificial lamb. Jonah is disgusted by the Ninevites. Jesus says, "There is great joy in heaven when even one sinner repents." Jonah distances himself from the city. Jesus moves right in. And just like this large fish couldn't keep Jonah down, the tomb couldn't keep Jesus down either. And after 3 days, Jesus rose again, the first fruit of a new creation. A new creation that will see the glory and the honors of the nations coming into it. Just as we have this foretaste of the great city of Nineveh. And now, after his ascension into heaven and his gift of the Holy Spirit, Christ continues to be patient like his father. He continues to call sinners to repentance. Jesus continues through his Spirit to remind us that God's grace is enough. Through Jesus, God will even receive racist prophets like Jonah into his kingdom. Through Jesus, God will receive reputable sinners like the Ninevites into his kingdom. Through Jesus, God will receive every single sinner who repents and turns to him, the Good Shepherd. With or without us, everyone, God will tell stories of grace. With or without us, God will bring redemption to those in need. With or without us, God will offer salvation to those who are lost. And with or without us, God will do what only God can do: turn souls to repentance, turn death to life, turn feet to dancing, and turn spirits to song. I don't know about you, but I'd like to go with God on that journey. Because with the help of the Holy Spirit, we will repent of our prejudice. We will not only see the glory and the honor of the nations flocking into the new creation, we will know each other by name. We will know each other by name. Well, God's people say, amen. Let's pray. Lord God and Heavenly Father, there is nothing wrong with us living out in the burbs. No, there's nothing wrong with you blessing us with both material and spiritual health and well-being. But there is a problem, Lord, when we become so distanced from all those in need, that it impacts the wonderful and beautiful mission of making disciples of all nations, all peoples, those in the inner city, those on the outskirts, those in the suburbs, those in the country. All sinners created in the image of God who need your grace. Lord, use us. Use even this church, Covenant Church. Bless us. Lead us like a good shepherd. Give us strength and wisdom and opportunities to get to know those you put in our path, to see and experience the glory and the honor of the nations in the new creation that is already here in ways right now. Lord, what a privilege that is. Fill us with your Spirit, we pray. In Jesus' precious name, amen. Please stand in body or in spirit for our song of response, Your Grace is Enough. So with the sinner's heart. Our offerings, brothers and sisters, will be received at the door for work of the deacons and all of our church ministries here at the church. Let's go to God in prayer. Lord God and Father, we know that from the beginning of the church, from Old Testament times into New Testament times and on to today, giving for the needs of the poor have always been a wonderful part of your worship. Lord, it is just a small reminder of how we give back when you've given us your all. Lord God, I just pray that you would bless our deacons and the work that they do on our behalf as they go into the city, they go into the suburbs, they go into the country, on our behalf as the hands and feet of Christ, and they try to show compassion, Lord. And we just pray that you would bless them, Lord, in all the work that they do. And we're thankful that we could give towards that so that they can do good work. We're also thankful for our church and the ministries that we get to do here and the worship we do and the discipleship that can go on and the outreach that we are trying to do. Lord, I just pray that you would bless us and use the funds that we give, Lord, to make all those things a living reality. We pray it all in your precious name. Amen. As you leave this place, may the living Lord go with you. May he go behind you to encourage you, beside you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, beneath you to sustain you, and always before you to show you the way. Amen.
Thanks, everyone.